I'm also happy to be here, and I know some of the faces, I think, probably from workshops you did with me. That's me when I left academia. And the title of my little introduction is From Academia to Industry and Back. And I'm only focusing today on the side of my academic career and maybe hit ground a little bit on industry, but I'm not want to spend much time there. First thing I would like to share with you, or two things. My family background is that I come out of a working class family. And we would, when we would look to literature, literature would say women and working class families is a little bit difficult because we don't get the right imprints on how to move in the academic society, one thing. But things are changing. And another thing I would like to say, I have no children, which relieved me from a lot of the career struggles women with children have. So I could really focus on what it is that I wanted to do. I did study, and I studied at the Salk Institute in the States, where I did my PhD in plant biology. And this brings me to one of the first wow moments in life. I was so unbearably fascinated when I learned about the DNA structure. You have to imagine, I studied in the 1980s at the University of Oldenburg, and most of the time we had systematics in zoology and botany and things, but nothing like biochemistry. And I got to learn about biochemistry, and my heart almost exploded. And this then brought me to plant biotechnology, because I said, this is exactly your field. And if you go with me today on an excursion as a plant biologist, I only know two plants, so you really can count on this knowledge. A second thing I learned while I was at the Salk Institute, and this was also a real wow moment, I was so fascinated by the energy my colleagues and I had. It was such a nice collegial environment. Everybody was into science, and unfortunately, this meant working day and night. But this is what science is a little bit all about. I call it the commitment for the career. But everybody really enjoyed it, and I enjoyed very much the time with them. Afterwards, or maybe also at the Salk and then at the university and ETH, where I did two postdocs, I really enjoyed that I always was at the edge of science. So when I came from the States and I moved to Switzerland, I have to say it was really a time when you saw the trends and you could identify really nice research fields. Unfortunately, I did not always do the best choices, I have to say. So I should have done probably a little bit different research for my postdoc. I also learned about the added value of getting to know people and leaders in the field. At the Salk Institute, this was a really open environment. I don't know if you know the Salk Institute. Jonathan Salk is very well known for his March of Dimes, the vaccination for polio. And we had visiting scientists coming from everywhere. And it was really easy, accessible, and you could just walk out and speak to them. So still, after the two postdocs I did, I decided to leave academia because for me, the job profile of becoming a professor was not so attractive, and I moved to private industry. I did two things there. First, I was a headhunter for highly educated people, and later I became a manager in the reinsurance industry. And this is where I come to the point of industry and back. Because when I decided that I would like to become self-employed, I said to myself, what it is that you really want to do? And I said, I would like to share all of the things I learned in industry with people in academia. And I founded my company in 2005, a time when there was not a lot of career service, not a lot of advices around. And I'm really happy that I have like 50% of the engagements I have, I do with universities. And a fair share of it is with women empowerment. And I really like to do this. What else is there? I was then asked in the preparation to identify hurdles I had while I studied. And I have to admit, it was a really hard time thinking. Because when I was doing my PhD, of course I encountered things like not a lot of face time with the supervisor, but he was a really big shot. Presentation slots were short, role models. I have to say, I had a role model, a female role model that was not so helpful for me. it was like a 2000% commitment for the job, and I was then starting to ask myself, is this what you, how you see your life? And I started to think about these things. But to be honest with you, I thought about it. I thought, Monica, what was happening to you while you studied? And I only encountered some of the things when I started to read the literature on behalf of what it is that I could do with women and women empowerment classes on the side of how to structure your academic career path. And I might say some of the things on the next slide. Huh? So in addition to these wow and STEM moments, I thought that we had been asked to come up with some ideas on what is this that makes us, what we should kind of think about when we look to working in a male-dominated environment. And this is personal experience, it's a little bit literature data, and it also comes a little bit from women who entrusted me information about their personal careers. And I thought I'd start with four different things, and one of the things I still see very often is that women hope to be discovered. Science is all about discovery, I completely agree. But recently I had a postdoc in my office and I said, so what do you want to do with your future? And she said, I want to become a professor. And I said, did you tell anybody? No, no, they have to figure this out on their own. I said, maybe we have to change the strategy there a little bit, right? So I call it demand the window space. Don't allow others to put you or other women down. Sorry, that sounds like very strange. But sometimes I'm observing very unpolite behavior. And it is up to us to not accept this. And it's up to us to not accept this. So show solidarity. Don't volunteer for support tasks. This, again, is something for what is very well described in literature. So soon as working groups are installed, women raise their hand and say, I do the protocol, I do whatever I do, and the guys, they pick the window sheets, if I may say so. Claim the recognition, and finally, don't go for the second best. And if I would need to make the linkage to academia, I would like to say that sometimes, I have women in coaching who are applying for professorships. And they come to see me in the office, and we start to talk about what they should ask for. And they say, I'm asking for the minimum, just that I can survive. Three co-workers and whatever they ask for. I say, no, 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 we don't ask for the minimum. We ask for the maximum. Put some more things onto the table so that people see, I know about it, I want the same office space, I at least want 10 co-workers, You later always can come back and say, okay, I can live with 6 or 7 people. Finally, I don't know why I came to the conclusion that I should talk about it, but I decided to do so. So some career development insights. And we already heard about the visibility and the networking. And I, in my career planning workshops, really like to encourage women to try to become a member of an appointment committee, to see how decision-making is done, to see how structures are, to see how people look to the CVs and what is important. Another thing is, my colleagues call this the mentor, and I kind of call it the ambassador. And I call it the ambassador because mentoring today in my world is something else than it was 20 years ago. In the old days, the mentor and mentee relationship also was lifelong, and the mentor really looked out for the mentee. And I really like it that today we have so many mentoring programs, but very often they are time limited for 1 year, and then people move on. So the idea with the ambassador is that this is somebody who's really helping you career-wise, and not after 1 year turns around and you are all alone again. I'm running out of time, probably. Learn about hidden career elements and invest time in decision making. This is always easy to say, but on behalf of the workshops I do, I try to look for career elements people normally don't talk about. And one of the things, for example, is really appointment committees. Another thing is, do I know anything about the organization I'm living in? This week I gave a workshop for life science, and the students were supposed to bring an organigram from the ETH and from the university and to share where are the decision makers, what is the name of the rector, anything. And I have to say, nobody knew something about the environment they are living. Okay, and maybe finally, the last thing I would like to say in the other things you have read already is, when it comes to networking, and this is a very femaleish thing to say, don't go with the sympathies. Go with what you can get. When I was in the States, I knew people all over the world. I had a really big network, and all I did was, I looked at you and say, do I like you? Do I want to network with you? I never looked at the thing with a way, what can the two of us gain out of the relationship? Okay, that's it. Thank you very much.